The End of Time by Gavin Extence. Read by Homer Todiwala. Part 1. The Mediterranean Sea. Chapter 1. The Crossing. So there we stood, on the stony beach beneath the forest and the mountains and the stars. The land across the water was now only a smudge in the moonlight, and the crossing looked so very much further than it had on Google Maps. I remember this moment clearly. I was afraid. I turned to my little brother Mohammed and said, "We don't have to do this. You know that, don't you?" My brother's eyes shone briefly in the darkness. "God above, Zane," he hissed. "Don't be such a pussy." He did not use those actual words, of course, because we were talking in Arabic. But in this instance, I've translated his phrasing very closely. The same anatomy was referenced in both cases. My little brother can be extremely insulting when he chooses to be. "Our mother would not want you speaking that way," I rejoined. "Well, Mum's not here, is she?" There was not much I could say to this, so I said nothing at all. I just looked at him and tried to imitate the expression our father would have made in this situation. Calm, patient and still in control. An undertone of quiet disappointment. "You were raised better than this, young man." It is possible that the many shades of my intention were lost to the darkness. Mohammed made an obscene gesture with his fist. "God, give me strength," I said beneath my breath, but loud enough that he could hear. Mohammed shrugged then, or he attempted to shrug. The life jacket made the movement awkward. It was too big for him, even after I had knotted the straps twice over to tighten the fit. This was one of the many things that continued to occupy my mind. I turned back to the sea and, stepping forward, let the waves run over my bare feet. It stung straight away, and it felt far colder than it probably was. You have to bear in mind that we'd been walking for much of the day, over bare rock and baked, rutted ground. My feet were blistered and swollen, and that first shock of cool salt water felt like needles in my flesh. Nevertheless, I tried not to react, or not in any way that would be obvious to Mohammed. I waited, instead, for the pain to diminish to a dull throb, allowing my feet and ankles to become used to their new environment. By logic, I knew that the sea, in August, was not much colder than the night air. It might even have been a little warmer. And it was, essentially, the same sea I had swum in for much of my life, just a little further west. It was not something to be feared. "How far do you think it is?" Mohammed asked me.
2 kilometres, 3 at the most." I could not, in good conscience, lie about this, however much I wanted to.
Because of the time we'd spent hiding from the police, who patrolled the roads and beaches closer to town, we'd not covered as much ground as we'd hoped. We had not been able to get to the narrowest point in the channel, where little more than 1 kilometre of water separates Turkey from the Greek island of Samos. But there was no chance now of continuing overland. We might spend another 3 hours stumbling along in the darkness, our energy failing, and with nowhere to refill our water bottles. So the choice we faced was simple. Accept defeat and turn back, or attempt the swim from here. But I was never going to be the one to make the final call. When it came down to it, I could no more command my little brother into the water than I could tell him to leap into a fire. It was he who broke our silence by summoning a large quantity of phlegm into his throat and spitting it into the sea. A 14-year-old's act of defiance.
"Let's do this," he said.
We drank the last of our water and then discarded the empty bottles on the beach, where they lay as a small sacrilege in the moonlight. Most of our belongings, such as they were, we'd left at the hotel in town. A change of clothes, some toiletries. In terms of material possessions, there was no longer much to abandon. Everything else, everything essential, had been sealed in waterproof bags and squashed into our backpacks. Let me ask you to imagine this. You are going to attempt to swim across the sea to a whole new continent. Everything you can take with you has to fit into one small backpack, and every gram you pack will be a gram acting against you, a gram seeking to pull you down beneath the waves. So what do you take?
Some things are obvious. You take your shoes and sunglasses and one set of lightweight clothing, and not only because you do not wish to offend your new host nation with your nakedness. You assume that in the morning you'll have to walk many miles under the hot Greek sun. You take your money and your phone, which you've double-bagged for extra insurance. You take your passport because it is proof of your nationality, proof of your desperation, in case swimming across the sea does not in itself prove that you are desperate. These are the practical things I had packed into my backpack, along with two more items for the benefit of my soul. The first was a photograph of my parents, taken before the war began, and it was stowed within the pages of the second, which was a copy of my holy book. This was a hardback English-language edition of The God Delusion by Richard Dawkins, which I'd concealed in the dust jacket from Charles Dickens's Great Expectations, so that no one would know that I was an apostate. But I'm sure I'll get to that later. It's not so important right now. After some experimentation and many adjustments, Mohammed and I had managed to secure the shoulder straps of our backpacks under our life jackets, which we now inflated, and we stood for only a moment in this state, like two fat blue-black turtles poised at the edge of the world. Then Mohammed started to wade forward into the surf, and I was at once pursuing, until in several clumsy bounds I had drawn beside him, waist-deep in the dark Aegean Sea. "Whatever happens," I told him, "whatever happens, we stay together, side by side." For once he did not object to this plan. He just nodded. I started counting, very slowly. 1, 2, 3. Together, we plunged into the water. Chapter 2. The First Attempt. This was not our first attempt to get into Europe. The first time, we'd tried it the conventional way. We paid the smugglers 1,000 euros each for a place on an overladen dinghy with a malfunctioning outboard motor. We were told when we handed over the money, half of everything we had, that we'd be travelling in a small group with perhaps 15 to 20 other refugees. A cattle truck picked us up just after midnight and drove us to the coast. Inside were 57 other refugees, men, women, and children. I know because I had plenty of time to count them, and having done so, I was quick to reassure myself that this situation would not last. I did some elementary mathematics and spent the rest of the journey with the naive hope that there would be at least 3 boats waiting to ferry us to Europe. The journey to the coast took 3 hours. We sat on the wooden floor with our 59 bodies all squashed together, roasting in the darkness. Sometimes a child would cry and a parent would respond with comforting noises, but other than that, nobody spoke. The truck stank of animal feces and sweat and fear. We were stopped twice during the journey. Both times the engine was left running, but over its noise I could hear swift words being exchanged in Turkish. Each encounter lasted no more than 3 minutes, and the back of the cattle truck was never investigated. Bribery was occurring. Perhaps I don't need to spell this out, but I'm not sure. If you're hearing this, you're probably from the West, and people from the West don't always understand the way the rest of the world works. This is not a criticism, just an observation. After the second stop, the roads got rougher. For maybe 30 minutes we were bounced and jostled and ground together like peppercorns in a mill. It might have been dangerous, but for us being packed in so tightly, there was not far to fall. Then, at last, the truck stopped and the engine cut out. We were unloaded at the end of an unlit dirt track and allowed no more than 10 minutes to stretch our limbs and drink from our water bottles and savour the free air. After that, we were herded by torchlight to the sea. Our herders were 2 men armed with rifles. They looked cold and intimidating. They looked the way armed men always look. The ground was hard and uneven, and the only path was the one that had been trampled by previous footsteps. There were men carrying small children and women carrying babies. There were people who had recent injuries and people who were sick or malnourished. And the pace set by the armed Turks was not a gentle one. Several people stumbled or fell, and when others went to their aid, they were shouted at in a foreign language. The whole time, Mohammed remained silent and kept his eyes to the ground. The sight of him filled me with remorse. I regretted putting us in this terrible situation. And in truth, I doubt there was a single person in our group who did not harbour feelings similar to mine. If not now, then certainly later. Later, we all had our regrets. On the beach, two more Turks were waiting with the boat, the single dinghy, which had already been inflated and was resting on the stones not too far from the water's edge. I'd estimate it was about 5 meters long by 2 meters wide and was probably designed to hold a maximum of 15 adults. The shouting started almost at once, and it was then that I realized why our hosts were armed. Before, it hadn't made much sense. After all, we were all here of our own free will. We'd each paid 1,000 euros for the privilege. So my hypothesis had been that the guns were in case we ran into the police or the Coast Guard or a rival criminal gang. It was only on the beach, once the shouting began, that I understood. The guns were to protect the smugglers from us, from the inevitable riot that would otherwise have ensued. Despite the guns, one of my braver companions stepped forward and addressed the Turks in halting, broken English. "You can't think us to get on this boat," he shouted. "We do not pay our money for this." The Turk, who seemed to be in charge, smiled at this point. It was the first time I had seen any of them smile, and it was in no way reassuring. He stroked the barrel of his rifle, then gestured with the beam of his torch at the sea. "Europe is that way, my friend, but if you prefer..." He pointed the torch back the way we had just come, like a flight attendant pointing to the emergency exits. "The road is that way. It's about 2-hour walk to town." There was a long and awful silence. Then the Turk nodded to himself, still smiling. "Who else speak English here?" After a moment, a few hands went up, then a few more. Mahmed nudged me in the ribs. I don't know why. Maybe he thought my superior command of English might win us a better seat. With much reluctance, I also raised my hand. The Turk swung his torch beam across us in an arc. I was holding my breath, and I think I was not the only one. A second later, the torch beam settled just to my left on a tall man of about 40 years. I noticed then that this man's raised arm was not shaking, as I'm sure mine was. His expression was completely neutral. "You, my friend," the Turk said, "you are going to be our pilot. You know what pilot is?" The man in the torch beam nodded. "Good, you come with me." I thought at first this was a joke, but it soon became evident that it was not. The man who had just been volunteered to steer us to Europe was taken over to the back of the dinghy, where one of the other Turks began to instruct him on how to work the outboard motor. Meanwhile, the rest of us were left to put on our life jackets, and in many cases, to say our prayers. Most of us had brought life jackets with us, because you could buy them cheaply in Turkish supermarkets. These days, you could buy a life jacket pretty much anywhere in Western Turkey. People sold them on unfolded blankets all along the seafronts. But if you'd somehow managed to miss all these opportunities, the smugglers were also happy to provide them for 100 euros apiece. We were soon hustled into a queue at the water's edge, where we waited. 59 men, women and children, holding in our arms the bags that contained everything we now owned. Apart from the sound of the waves, there was absolute silence. "I'm not sure we should do this," I whispered to Mohammed. He gave me a look that said, "What choice do we have?" I suspect it was what everyone else on that beach was also thinking, apart from the very young children. They were probably thinking only that they wanted to go home. It took all four Turks and some men pulled back from the queue to launch the boat. Then we had to wade nearly up to our waists and climb in. The families with children went first, and lots of the children were crying. People had to sit on their bags with their children in their laps to free up space, and there still wasn't enough. The boat filled from the centre outwards as the Turks held it steady in the water, and the seating got ever more precarious, with the last men to board having to perch on the outer edge of the dinghy. You wouldn't have thought it possible, but somehow everyone got on, and the boat was so low in the water that every wave threatened to flood us. The Turks guided the boat further out to sea, then instructed our pilot to activate the outboard motor. It sputtered to life and we started to move ever so slowly out onto the open water. At this point, the smuggler who seemed to be in charge started to wave at us with much theatricality.
"Goodbye, my friends! Safe travels! A great future in Europe is waiting you!"
His body diminished in the darkness, and within moments, he was gone. Europe was not visible yet, not even as points of light on a dark shore, so our boat was heading out to sea with only a smuggler's promise that we were going in the right direction, which is a guarantee not even as reliable as blind faith. Several of my travelling companions seemed to agree, and within seconds of setting out, a number of smartphones had appeared from pockets and waterproof bags, the light from their screens cutting the darkness. I followed this example and, switching on my GPS, saw that we were indeed moving towards Europe. We were heading to the Greek island of Lesbos. I measured the distance on the map with my thumb, and it was about 8 kilometres. Mohammed and I were squeezed towards the back of the boat, not far from the motor. This, it turned out, was an especially bad place to be on account of the noise and the smell of burning petrol. Crammed in near us were a heavily pregnant woman and her husband, and the woman was holding a scarf across her nose and mouth in a futile attempt to block out the fumes. Neither of them was wearing a life jacket. It was possible that they'd spent the last of their money to be on this boat. It was after half an hour or so that the engine started making troubling noises, and 5 minutes after that, it died completely. The petrol fumes vanished, but an unmistakable smell of scorched electrics remained. Within seconds, there was chaos. Men and women were shouting on top of each other. Children were crying. Another man was battling with the pilot for control of the rudder, trying to hold the boat face on against the waves. And amidst all this, the pregnant woman began to scream and attempt to rise to her feet. Her husband quickly threw an arm around her, but she kept on screaming and fighting him, and every time she lurched upwards, the whole boat rocked, and there was even more screaming as water rushed over the sides and swirled around our feet. Then Mohammed also started getting to his feet, and I had to assume that he too was hysterical, even though his face was set in a grim and resolute frown. I tried to manoeuvre myself against the crush of all the other bodies, but before I could take any meaningful action, I saw in a flash my little brother's intention. Looking completely calm, he began releasing the straps on his too big life jacket, one by one. Then he slipped his head and neck free from the harness and presented the empty jacket to the pregnant woman and her husband, never saying a word. Most of the people on board our tiny vessel could not have seen this action, so the general shouting and rocking continued as before. But the pregnant woman at least did stop screaming. She sank back to the wet floor of the boat, sobbing and clutching the life jacket to her chest. The husband looked like a man who'd been given an electric shock, and to me his dilemma was obvious. He didn't want his wife and unborn child to drown, and neither did he want to be responsible for the death of a 14-year-old boy. So I did the only thing I could in this situation, having been put to so much shame by my little brother. I, in turn, wriggled out of my life jacket and placed it over Mohammed's shoulders. "It's okay," I shouted to the husband in Arabic, trying to propel my voice above the general din. "I am a strong swimmer, the strongest in all of Syria." I do not know if he heard me or not, so I tried to mime with my hands a fish gliding through the water. He may not have understood this either. The boat did not capsize. After a while, people stopped panicking and started talking until it was concluded that the only good option was to phone the Greek Coast Guard and give him our GPS coordinates. Several passengers had had the foresight to look up and store the number before we left Turkey. Not one of us spoke Greek, of course, but it was soon discovered that I had by far the best English of anyone on that boat. When I say it was discovered, what I actually mean is that Mohammed volunteered this information. "You should let my brother speak," he declared, while two other Syrians were arguing over who should take the responsibility for the phone call. "He is a student of English literature at Tishrin University. It's likely that he speaks the language far better than either of you." Mohammed has never been reluctant to voice his opinions, even in adult company. So I made the phone call, and the Greek Coast Guard also spoke good English, because, as you know, it is the second language of most European professionals. I explained the situation in brief, and, as you can imagine, it was a situation that the Greek Coast Guard had experienced many times before. There was a short wait after I gave him our GPS coordinates, and then he informed me that our boat was not yet in Greek waters. We were still, at present, Turkey's problem. I asked him if he intended to leave us in the middle of the sea. Me and my little brother and the pregnant woman and the many crying children. He replied that of course he didn't, and he'd be calling the Turkish Coast Guard the moment our conversation was finished. Someone would be there to pick us up as soon as possible. I thanked him and hung up. The rest of the boat looked at me expectantly. "We're going back to Turkey," I said. The shouting started once more, and now it was all directed at me. I guess it took another hour. The shouting ceased, the boat bobbed up and down on the waves, and we all tried to stay as still as possible. Someone with a phone turned on the torch and shone it into the darkness periodically, like a tiny lighthouse. When the Turkish Coast Guard arrived, he swiftly made the decision that there was no hope of towing us back to shore. Instead, a small ladder was lowered and one by one we were loaded onto the much larger boat. Blankets and towels were offered to anyone who was thought to be in shock, which was most of us, and then we headed back to the nearest port. The dinghy was left as it was, bobbing silently in the darkness. At the dock, we were turned loose. If this surprises you, then you have not been to Turkey recently. There are millions of refugees there, most of them from my country, and I don't know exactly how many of us were trying to escape to Europe every single night, but my guess is thousands. The point is that no one needed to ask where we'd come from or what we were doing in a rubber boat in the middle of the sea in the middle of the night. They already knew, because our situation was completely unremarkable. So nobody needed to investigate us, and nobody wanted to detain us. And there was nowhere else they could send us. So we were turned loose, immediately. On the dock, we were approached by the husband of the pregnant woman. He handed Mohammed's life jacket over to me, and then he kissed me on both cheeks. Then he kissed Mohammed on both cheeks. This is not a homosexual act where I come from. It is a sign of deep friendship or gratitude. There was a small silence, after which he patted Mohammed's shoulder a couple of times and then returned to his wife, who was sitting on the ground huddled in a blanket. I've often wondered what happened to the two of them. In all likelihood, they never made it to Europe. If they were lucky, their baby may have been born in a tent in an overcrowded refugee camp. "What you did was extremely brave," I told Mohammed later. "Our parents would be proud of you." He looked at me like this was the most embarrassing thing he'd ever heard. "I'm proud of you too," I told him. "For God's sake, Zane," Mohammed rolled his eyes at me. "What else was I going to do? That woman was fucking crazy. She was going to tip the whole lot of us into the water. If I hadn't acted, all our stuff, all of our money, would be at the bottom of the sea right now." I thought about this for a while. "So you gave her your life jacket because you were worried about our stuff? Is that what you're telling me?" "Damn right it is." There was a small, strange silence. "I'm still proud of you," I said. Mohammed stomped around in the dirt for a few moments, letting out another string of expletives. Then he suddenly started to laugh. He dropped to his knees and hugged his chest, shaking uncontrollably. "What is funny?" I asked. He looked up and pointed at me, still shaking, and then flexed his small 14-year-old's biceps. "I'm the strongest swimmer in all of Syria," he declared. It was a terrible impression, but it made me smile. I launched myself at him and tried to put him in a headlock, but he managed to elbow me in the ribs and wriggle free. After that, we sat together on the grimy pavement and looked at the boats in the harbour. We were in a coastal town somewhere in Turkey, but apart from that, I had not a clue. "So, what now?" Mohammed asked. Chapter 3. The Middle of the Sea. The world had shrunk to a pool of pale moonlight, no more than a few metres across. Mohammed was to my left and just slightly ahead, since I was determined to keep him in my sight at all times. And we were both doing a slow, energy-efficient breaststroke, since this is the only stroke you can attempt while wearing a life jacket and a sodden backpack. Beyond our moonlit pool, there was only a wall of impenetrable blackness. Yet it did not feel dangerous at first. I should stress that. Compared to the journey with the smugglers, it felt almost peaceful. While we were still close to the shore, and we still had our energy, while there was still the possibility of turning back, it was not at all that different from swimming in the sea off the coast of Latakia. The familiar rhythm of limbs and muscles and breaths worked in harmony. Tuck, breathe in, stretch, breathe out, repeat. It was only later, after maybe an hour of swimming, that things became difficult. In the middle of the channel, the water was colder and more turbulent. The waves were a metre high and the current had started to shift, so that we were being pushed off our straight-line course. And by then, the straps of my life jacket and backpack had started to bite into my shoulders. Progress was slow. But I kept my eyes fixed on Mohammed. I kept my eyes fixed and my arms and legs moving, and so did he, and we edged closer and closer to Europe. It was then that something unfathomable happened. Our pool of light was suddenly contracting and dimming, and within moments the darkness had swallowed everything. Mohammed disappeared, the whole world disappeared, and I was left alone and sightless in a vast, incomprehensible abyss. You are probably like me. You've probably lived your whole life in a city and have no experience of what true darkness is like. So let me tell you, it's terrifying, especially when it descends in already threatening circumstances. This is why I reacted as I did. I stopped swimming with a gasp and swallowed a mouthful of seawater. Then I started coughing uncontrollably. It was this that made me realize I was not yet dead, which had been the wild thought surging in my mind. That this was the infinite blackness of death, and soon I would be judged and surely found wanting. Something grabbed my arm, just below the elbow. It took a moment to identify it as a human hand. Mohammed? I shouted. Mohammed, please tell me it's you. Who else would it be? His voice was as breathless as mine. God, what happened? Where did you go? Even as I asked this, the light started to return. I thrust my shoulders and neck back as another wave lifted me, and as I did, I saw the blazing moon re-emerging from behind a cloud. Beyond this, there was a clear streak of sky in which hundreds of stars were spread like glitter. I thought it was the most beautiful sight I'd ever seen. "Are you okay?" Mohammed asked me. I panicked and swallowed some seawater. "You're okay now?" "Yes, I'm okay now." "We need to keep swimming." "Which way?" "To Europe." "I mean, which way? I've lost all sense of direction." "Swim against the waves. Keep the moon over your left shoulder." He tugged at my arm and then pushed once more into the waves. It was fortunate that at least one of us was keeping his wits. We swam and we swam. My arms ached and my legs ached and my mouth was as dry as ashes and my lips stung like they'd been rubbed with sandpaper. The flesh of my neck and shoulders and armpits had been flayed by the life jacket, and every stroke was an act of self-torture. I had to assume that Mohammed was also feeling all of this and more. His pace had slowed, and even over the waves and the blood rushing in my ears, I could hear him panting with exertion. Time had ceased to have any meaning, but I knew that we were more than halfway now. We were still battling the current that was pulling us off our original course, but the waves were no longer working against us. They were coming in diagonally behind us. I would have feared that we'd somehow been turned around, but the moon was still there over my left shoulder, and soon pinpricks of light became visible ahead, like tiny fireflies blinking into existence.
"I can see Europe!" I shouted. "I can see the lights of Europe!"
Mohammed didn't respond. He just kept swimming. The black shore was rising in front of us when he finally stopped moving. I don't think it was a conscious decision he made, not when we were so close to our goal. He just had nothing left to give.
He slumped upright in the water with his life jacket holding his head just clear of the small waves. He had his eyes closed, and when I slapped his cheek, he was unresponsive. So I did the only thing I could. I took hold of his life jacket with my left hand, and with my right I continued to swim. It was like pulling a lead weight through the water, and there wasn't a muscle in my body that wasn't screaming. But I just kept going and going. I clawed at the water, and in tiny increments, we moved forward. I think I hear the throb of an engine as we approach the beach, but it's impossible to be sure. When you're utterly exhausted, the line between reality and imagination disappears. I heave my brother's limp body onward, and then as I kick out, my foot makes sudden contact with sand and stones. I lurch forward against the shelving seabed, dragging myself and Muhammad into the shallows and towards our salvation. And then he is ripped from my grasp. There's no longer enough water to hold him up, so I have to get my arms under him, and somehow, against a rush of dizziness, I manage to haul him out of the sea and stagger a few paces up the beach. I try to lower him gently onto the rocks, but my knees give out and we both collapse to the ground. I'm aware of cold stone pressing into my cheek. I'm aware of warm blood in my mouth. I'm aware of Muhammad's chest still rising and falling, rising and falling, against my pinned hand. This is the last I am aware of. My mother's voice is an urgent whisper. She tells me that I need to leave now, repeats it for the third or fourth time, and all the while she holds me in a tight, tight embrace, unable to let go. I don't want her to. I want her to say she's changed her mind. We should stay together, me, her, and Muhammad, whatever the cost. It's a hot evening in early August, not long after sunset. The sort of evening where people stay out late, eating in seafront restaurants, enjoying the sights and sounds of summer. That's what I might be doing in different circumstances. A quiet coffee shop or cafe, easy conversation with friends. As recently as 2 weeks ago, life was relatively normal. There's been fighting to the north, where the Free Syrian Army and various Islamist militias are gaining ground. But Latakia itself is a government stronghold. We're one of the last cities in Syria to remain completely under the regime's control. Mum's phone buzzes against the kitchen counter. She can't ignore it. She releases me and wipes her eyes with her sleeve. It's the car. It's outside. Simple words, but spoken like a death sentence. Mum, I don't know if I can do this. I'm not... You can do this. You have to. I want to tell her again that I can't. I'm 19 years old and I've never been away from home for more than a few days. I'm scared. Terrified. She rests her hands on my shoulders, forcing me to look her in the eye. Zain, you have to take care of Muhammad. You're the only one who can. I take a breath, then nod, not trusting myself to speak. Muhammad is in his room. Mum asked him to wait there a moment so that she could talk to me alone. He's hardly said a word all day, but when I saw him last, his eyes were rimmed red. Despite everything, he still won't let anyone see him cry. Zen, if there was another way... Mum trails off, closing her eyes for a moment. When she opens them again, her look is fierce and determined. Your dad, I have to stay here if I'm going to help him. I have to try. You understand that, don't you? Of course. I nod once more as firmly as I can. I'll look after Muhammad. I'll make sure he's safe. Mum doesn't say anything. She hugs me again, and I can feel her heart pounding against my chest. The moment stretches and the phone cuts the silence a second time, horribly loud and insistent. The driver. We don't know much about the man who will take me and Muhammad to the Turkish border. A friend of a friend gave us his details, but we were told he's made the trip at least a dozen times before, and when he spoke to Mum, he claimed there was little that could go wrong. We'll pass several checkpoints on the 60-kilometre journey, both government and opposition, but he's never met a soldier who turned down a bribe. Mum emptied her savings account a week ago, before the regime could freeze her assets, and thinks there'll be enough to get us all the way to Western Europe. Everything's been prepared, and now there's no turning back.
You're going to be okay. She repeats it like a mantra. You're going to be okay. She touches my cheek. One last time. Chapter 4. Resurrection. I came round with fingers poking me in the neck. The fingers belonged to a man who was clearly not a European. In the grey pre-dawn light, I could make out mottled skin that appeared somewhat darker than mine, and white hair and an unkempt white beard, and large thick eyebrows that somehow had managed to stay black. He was wearing a life jacket identical to mine. They might have been bought in the same supermarket. I blinked my eyes fully open and croaked the first thing that came into my head, which was this. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Peace be upon you and God's mercy. It's a formal and polite way of greeting a Muslim. I don't know if you have anything similar in the Western world. You seem to get by using nothing more elaborate than good morning. If I'd hissed like a snake, the man I was greeting could not have leapt away faster. He slipped on the loose rocks and he ended up on his buttocks a little further down the beach, yelping a curse of which my brother would have wholly approved. He started laughing.
Bismillah! He exclaimed. You're alive?
Yes, I rasped. I am alive. I tried and failed to push myself to my feet. My right arm, it turned out, was still pinned under Muhammad's chest. I managed to slide it free. It was so numb. It might have belonged to a mannequin. Muhammad groaned, rolled, and stayed asleep. Attempt 2. I maneuvered myself until I was kneeling, then pushed against the rocks with my one good hand. My legs wobbled in protest. I was so weak I could barely stand. In a moment, the man had scrabbled over the rocks and had an arm under my shoulder.
Easy, boy, he warned. It looks like you've had a tough night.
His accent was Iraqi. His face was deeply lined and he had a couple of teeth missing. I estimated his age to be between 55 and 75. It was hard to tell, because he looked as if he'd been recently blown up, which was not outside the realm of possibility. He smelled very strongly of alcohol.
Are we in Europe? I asked.
So I'm told, he replied.
I glanced around the beach. Apart from the three of us, it was deserted.
I don't think you should be standing yet, the old man said. I checked your pulse, but I couldn't find it.
He started chuckling again. I didn't know what to say, so I said nothing as he helped me back into a sitting position. It was then that I noticed he wasn't wearing any shoes, and that he was also missing two fingers on his right hand, the index and the third finger. They ended in stumps just below where the knuckles should have been.
Where are your shoes? I asked.
This seemed the politer inquiry.
Ha! Huh? My shoes? Where are your shoes, boy? Where are your clothes? What in God's name happened to you?
I was not naked. I should point that out. I was wearing swimming shorts as well as the life jacket and my backpack, which I hoped still contained the rest of my clothes. It took me a couple of attempts to unstrap the life jacket and toss it onto the beach. It was extremely painful, because my shoulders had been rubbed raw, but I was eager to be rid of it. I didn't feel too bad about abandoning it here, since the beach was already littered with several hundred other life jackets, as well as a number of inflatable boats which had been punctured and dragged onto the rocks. I upended the backpack and was relieved to discover that my waterproof bags had remained unbreached. I removed my trainers from one of the packages and held them, one in each hand. The old man was staring at them like I'd just pulled a rabbit from a hat.
I'm sorry, I told him. I don't have any spares.
What happened to you? He repeated. Did your boat sink?
No. No boat. We swam.
From Turkey?
I shrugged and gestured at Muhammad. It was my brother's idea. Muhammad had started snoring. I gave him a small shake, then a more vigorous shake, and he swiped his arm at me as if trying to swat away a fly.
Muhammad, wake up! We have company!
He groaned. The Iraqi grinned widely, showing off his missing teeth.
Typical teenager, yes?
I started to laugh. And it may sound strange, but let me tell you, I felt so damn good in that moment. because despite everything, despite being exhausted and weak with hunger and thirst, despite the aches and sores that I could feel all over my body, in that moment, I knew we were alive. We were alive and we were in Europe, and for the time being at least, we were safe. It took a lot more shaking before Mohammed woke up, and when he did, he was every bit as disorientated as I had been. He spent some time patting his still-inflated life jacket while eyeing the Iraqi with great suspicion. "Who's the old man?" he said eventually. "You'll have to excuse my brother," I said. "He's also had a difficult night." The Iraqi was waving away this apology even as I was making it.
"The whole world's gone to hell anyway. If there was ever a time for plain speaking, it's now."
"What happened to your fingers?" my brother asked.
"Mohammed!" "Ha! The boy calls the one-eyed man one-eyed, doesn't he?"
He looked at Mohammed for a moment, then said,
"Al-Qaeda happened to my fingers."
He held his good hand flat and made a chopping motion against his stubs. I didn't say anything. Mohammed didn't say anything.
"Can you guess what my crime was?"
He looked at us expectantly. Even so, it took me several moments to realize that this wasn't a rhetorical question. He really did want us to guess.
"Was it blasphemy?" I asked.
"Theft," said Mohammed.
"My crime was smoking a cigarette," the old man told us.
"Can you believe that?"
"Yes, I can believe that," I said.
He nodded a couple of times. And then, because there was another silence, and because I was determined to mind my manners, even if the whole world was going to hell, I introduced us.
"I'm Zain," I said, "and this is my brother Mohammed. We're pleased to meet you."
The old man did not respond to this for a long time. He was staring at the sea, apparently lost in thought. I cleared my throat and was just about to repeat my introduction when the Iraqi suddenly turned to face us once more, a huge grin splitting his face.
"You may call me Isa," he said. "Isa al-Masi."
He slapped his thigh and started cackling. Isa, I should tell you, is the Arabic form of Jesus, and it's not an uncommon name in Islamic countries. Al-Masi means the Messiah. Going forward, it will be simpler if I just refer to the Iraqi as Jesus, or Jesus Christ, since this was the essence of his joke. He continued to cackle as I helped Mohammed out of his life jacket, which I then discarded on the beach next to mine. Jesus was almost certainly drunk. That was my strong hypothesis, given the smell and his general behaviour. But I still had no idea where he'd come from, or what had happened to his shoes. My swimming shorts were damp but not soaking, and since I was reluctant to strip off in front of Jesus, I thought it better to leave them on. I pulled on my plain grey t-shirt followed by my socks and trainers. Mohammed put on his FC Barcelona shirt, which he had worn every day since I bought it for him in a Turkish market. For the price we paid, it was certainly a counterfeit, but neither of us thought you could tell. On the back, it had a large number 10 and the name Messi in bright yellow letters. Jesus had managed to stop laughing by now, and once we were fully dressed, he hopped over to us and placed one hand on my shoulder and the other on Mohammed's.
"You boys look like you need some breakfast," he said. "Follow me."
He scrambled towards a tiny headland where the beach curved back on itself. He moved surprisingly swiftly, like a startled animal. Mohammed turned to me.
"I don't think we should follow him," he said.
"Why not?" I asked.
"Why not? Seriously? He's completely fucking batshit crazy."
Mohammed did not use those exact terms, of course. He used an Arabic idiom, likewise strewn with expletives, which carries much the same meaning. He raised a reasonable point, but at the same time, I couldn't see that we had any better option available to us.
"He must be going somewhere," I pointed out.
"He didn't just spring out of the ground. It's possible that he actually has some breakfast for us." My brother scoffed at this.
"It's also possible that he lives in a cave and paints the walls with his own shit."
"Many things are possible," I acknowledged.
Jesus had stopped 50 meters up the beach and was jumping up and down on his chicken-thin legs, waving frantically that we should follow. "Come on," I said. "I'm fairly sure he's harmless." Mohammed groaned loudly but raised no other objection. We shouldered our backpacks and followed the Messiah up the beach. Chapter 5. The Missing Shoes. We walked for maybe 10 minutes, our legs aching and our mouths desert dry and our shoulders still raw from the swim. Despite his lack of shoes, Jesus was able to cover the ground far quicker than us, so he stopped and waited periodically, always waving us on and shouting words of encouragement. We rounded the small rocky headland as the sun was coming up over the sea, and as it did, my heart leapt. On the beach below us, in a small clearing amidst 1,000 discarded life jackets, there sat a group of around 20 people, women and children mostly. The grey carcass of an abandoned dinghy was still bobbing in the shallows just behind them. Jesus was waiting for us with a fat smile.
"Here are some of your countrymen," he said. "There were more, but I guess some of them left straight away."
He gestured at a dirt track at the far end of the cove.
"Down is that way, I'm told. It's a 20-kilometer walk, so it makes sense to get moving before the sun gets too hot."
Mohammed frowned at this information.
"If town's that way, then why were you wandering off in the opposite direction?"
"Ha! That's a good question. I thought I was just taking a walk."
"Just taking a walk?"
"That's what I thought. Now I'm not so certain."
Jesus scratched his white beard for a moment.
"I have a different theory now. Would you like to hear it?"
I said yes at the same time as Mohammed said no. "Shut up, Mohammed," I said. "If you ask the question, you should be prepared to hear the answer."
"You shut up!"
"Go ahead," I told Jesus.
"I no longer want to tell you," Jesus said. "I fear you will laugh."
"Of course we won't. We won't laugh, will we, Mohammed?" My brother rolled his eyes and shrugged, which was as good an affirmation as I ever got from him. "Go ahead, Jesus," I repeated. He was staring out to sea with a look of intense concentration, as if trying to calculate a complicated sum in his head. Mohammed and I waited expectantly.
"I think I chose to walk in that particular direction because two boys had washed up on the beach. They obviously needed my help. That's what brought me."
I looked at Mohammed. Mohammed looked at me. Neither of us laughed because neither of us knew what Jesus was trying to say. I wasn't sure Jesus knew what he was trying to say either, but he'd started nodding to himself, very slowly, as if he'd uttered some profound piece of wisdom. "I'm sorry, Jesus," I said after a moment, "but I'm not certain you understood my brother's question. He wanted to know why you were walking away from town in the first place, on your own, in the opposite direction."
"I came to help you boys. You needed my help."
"Yes, but you didn't know we were there. Unless, did you see us from further up the beach? From up here? Is that what you're saying?"
"Pah! How could I see you from up here? It was dark and I have an old man's eyes. I didn't see you until I was almost on top of you."
"Right, so..."
"What you're saying makes no fucking sense," Mohammed interjected. "You didn't know we were there, so you couldn't have been coming to help us. Do you understand that?"
Jesus smiled patiently.
"But I did come to help you. Don't you see? It makes perfect sense to me now."
"It makes no sense,"
Jesus shrugged.
"Maybe God sent me."
Mohammed swore again, then put his fingers to his temple and mimed blowing his brains out with a handgun. "Jesus," I said as gently as I could, "I think perhaps you're reading too much into this situation. Why would God send you to us?" He thought about this for some time, regarding us both through squinting eyes.
"You boys are very young to be in a strange country on your own," he said. "Perhaps you need a guide."
"We don't need a guide," Mohammed retorted. "We have Google Maps."
"Google Maps will only take you so far," Jesus said.
He said it the way you might utter the words of an ancient proverb. Mohammed looked like he was about to snap again, so I decided it was time to kill the conversation, which was clearly getting us nowhere. "Shall we go?" I asked. A couple of minutes later, we were approaching the people assembled on the beach. Several of the women shot disapproving looks at Jesus. This did not surprise me.
"They swam from Turkey," he said by way of introduction. "I found them half drowned."
"We were not half drowned," Mohammed complained. "We were resting."
"You're Syrians," one of the women stated. She was also Syrian, it was clear from her accent. She was about 35 years old and had two little girls with her. I estimated the older of the two to be around 5 years old. She was half hiding behind her mother's shoulder. The other girl looked to be no older than 2 or 3. She was asleep in a blanket at her mother's feet. "I am Zain," I said, "and this is my brother Mohammed."
"It's just the two of you?" the woman asked very gently.
"Yes." She didn't press the point any further. No one did. This was something that had become pretty standard since leaving Syria. The real question, "Where are your parents?" never got asked, but always hung there in the background, as visible as the black smoke from a bomb blast. The woman spoke a couple of words over her shoulder to her older daughter, then came over and gave Mohammed a hug. I'm not sure how he felt about this. The women we met along the road often wanted to mother us, and I never had a problem with it. But, as you know, Mohammed was 14 and the world's biggest tough guy. He usually met any display of kindness or affection with a stiff-bodied silence. I thought I caught him wincing slightly, but that was probably because of the swim. If his shoulders were as bad as mine, he'd need some time to recover. The woman did not seem to notice his reaction. Once she'd finished with Mohammed, she came to me and placed a warm hand on my cold cheek. I am not the world's biggest tough guy. I'm sure by now you realize this as well. Most of the time I manage to hold it together, because what else can I do? But on this occasion, I could feel myself starting to unravel. Slowly, I reached up and removed the woman's hand. She looked a little upset herself, so I tried to give her a reassuring smile. But I doubt it was very convincing.
"You must be exhausted," she said. "When did you last eat? Have you had anything to drink?"
At once there was a general commotion as people started producing bottled water and chocolate and dried dates and flatbreads from their bags. This was everything they had left. Everything they'd brought to sustain themselves and their families until they reached civilization. And they were practically throwing it at us. Such is the nature of human beings sometimes. My hand shook violently as I lifted a water bottle to my lips. It was the finest breakfast I'd ever had. The woman who wanted to mother us was called Sabine. Her older daughter was called Aida, as in the famous Italian opera, and the younger was called Rihanna, as in, well, as in Rihanna. We also have Rihanna in Syria. I didn't ask about her husband for the same reason she didn't ask about our parents. In a situation like that, you have to assume the worst. We talked a little while Mohammed ate and ate, and every so often someone would interrupt to ask if we really had swum all the way from Turkey. Jesus stayed away from the main group, smoking and muttering to himself. He held his lit cigarette between the stubs of his amputated fingers. Every so often, another of the women would shuffle over and whisper in my ear that I should be wary of that man. He was a drunkard and unpredictable.
"He says his name's Jesus Christ the Messiah," I whispered back to them one by one.
There was a lot of tutting and head-shaking at this revelation, but no one had an alternative name to offer. Indeed, no one seemed to know a thing about him aside from his being a drunkard, which everyone had gleaned. He had been the only Iraqi on a boat full of Syrians, Afghans and Pakistanis, so it was generally surmised that he was travelling alone. He had spent much of the boat journey drinking from a litre bottle of whiskey, until at some point he had managed to get into a fight with one of the young Pakistani men. The Pakistani ended up throwing the whiskey overboard, and Jesus started hitting him with his shoes,
which he wore on his hands like boxing gloves. These had swiftly followed the whiskey into the Mediterranean Sea, at which point the men had been separated and Jesus was restrained for the rest of the short voyage. I had been on one of those terrible boats, as you know.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.